The Triassic stratigraphy of Spiti holds an important place in the Indian geology. Triassic belongs to the Mesozoic era. Meso word means middle life. The time period when the larger forms, the reptiles, they had started to proliferate on the terrestrial land, terrestrial area, while in the oceans. This was the time period when ammonoids were very, very dominant. Okay. So let us first have a brief introduction about the Triassic. What is Triassic? How it is defined? The name Triassic, it was given by Von Alberti. Von Alberti for a three-tier rock formation in Germany. And the three-tier rock formation means there were three layers. The lower one was the Bunter. Then Muschelkalk was the middle one. And upper was the Kuiper. So Bunter, Muschelkalk and Kuiper. On the basis of these three, Von Alberti gave the name Triassic. Okay. Triassic is a period. It holds the status of a period as a geochronologic unit and system as chronostratigraphic unit in the geological time scale. So if you see this table, the Triassic period or Triassic system belongs to the Mesozoic era or Mesozoic eratum. The transition from Paleozoic to Mesozoic means from the Permian period to the Triassic period is a very, very important geological event in the Earth's history. The Permian and Triassic, they are separated by an important extinction event, which is known as the Permo-Triassic extinction event or PT extinction event, which you can see over here, PT extinction event. PT extinction event is one of the, or we can say it is the most severe extinction, even greater than the KT boundary extinction. PT extinction event is also known as the Great Dying. Great Dying. More than 90% of the living forms, they disappeared. The age of the Permo-Triassic boundary is 251.9 million years. This is the most recent age. And at this boundary, the 80% of marine fauna disappeared. A lot of other organisms also died. Then the Siberian traps, the Siberian lava flows, they were formed at this Permo-Triassic boundary. The last stage of the last epoch of the Permian period was the Changsingian, and the earliest epoch of Triassic, which is the lower Triassic, it is separated from the Changsingian by this Permo-Triassic event that is known as the Permo-Triassic boundary. The lower or early Triassic was earlier, you know, that stage was known as Scythian. The Scythian. Scythian was later divided into Induan and Olenekian. So, the base of Triassic has been defined as the initial stage of recovery from PT extinction. Means, once the PT extinction event occurred, the Great Dying occurred, and the majority of forms disappeared from the Earth, then how is Triassic defined? That is why it is called as the middle life, you know, the time period when the life again started to emerge. The forms, they again started to appear, to take shape. So it was the initial stage of recovery. Recovery from what? Recovery from the PT extinction. The base of the Triassic is marked by the first occurrence of the Conodont Hindiodus parvus. See, this is it. This is Hindiodus parvus. It is a Conodont. So Conodont are phosphatic marine microfossils. Very, very important index fossils. And the GSSP of the base of Triassic, the initiation of Triassic is in China. So GSSP is the Global Stratotype Section and Point. Okay, GSSP. So the first occurrence of this conodont Hindiodus parvus, it marks the base of Triassic. You all should remember this. You know, it can come in any multiple choice questions in the GSI prelims exam. Then the next stage of the early Triassic is Olenekian. At this Indo-Olenekian boundary, this boundary, the GSSP of this boundary is in the Spiti Valley in India. This is the only GSSP which is in India. The candidate for this GSSP in India, Spiti Valley, is the Indo-Olenekian boundary. And some people say that the GSSP of this boundary is also in China. So there is a bit debate. But then if you look at the list of the GSSP, the Indo-Olenekian boundary GSSP is the only one which is in India. So the early Triassic epoch, it has Indo-Olenekian and Olenekian stages. They are the faunal stages. These stages have been defined on the basis of certain fossils, certain fauna. Then comes the middle Triassic. It has two stages, the lower Anisian and the upper Ladinian stage. So you should remember these names. Then the late Triassic has Carnian, Norian, and then Raetian. So this is how the Triassic period is defined, that the base of Triassic has been defined on the basis of first occurrence of Hindiodus parvus. Also, this is the time period when the initial stage of recovery started after the Permian Triassic extinction, a very, very important event. Now, the important fossil groups of Triassic, you know, the entire Mesozoic era, it has been defined on the basis of these marine fossils. You can say that the terrestrial areas had the important occurrences of dinosaurs and reptiles, but still in the biozonations, the Mesozoic has been defined on the basis of marine cephalopods, and that too more specifically ammonoids. So the once we talk about the marine fossils, the marine facies, then conodonts, ammonoids and bivalves, they were important fossils. It is not that you will not find brachiopods or gastropods. They are also there. Crinoids are there. Corals are there. But these three, they are important ones used to correlate the marine facies. While the terrestrial facies have been correlated with the help of pollens and spores. And if you see this, this is the combined map of Laurasia and Gondwana land. Okay. So this is South America, Africa, India, Australia, Antarctica. So you can see here, and this one, this is the Madagascar. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, all these land masses were joined. So this portion is the Gondwana land, while this one is the Laurasia. So you can see the position of Gondwana land and Laurasia during Triassic. So during the Triassic period, the first occurrence of a mammal-like dicynodont reptile, Lystrosaurus. This is Lystrosaurus, and its fossils have been found in these locations. So in the Gondwana land, it has been found in Africa, then India, Antarctica. Okay, so on this basis, it has, you know, it helps to know that all these continents were together at a time. So these fossils, then pollens and spores, they have been used to correlate the terrestrial facies. Now, another important thing was that during the late Triassic, a major biologic and climatic change was occurring, and it is coincided with the emergence of the earliest dinosaurs on land and calcareous nanoplanktons in the oceans. So, in the fossil record, you will not find the first occurrence of calcareous nanoplanktons before Triassic. Keep it in mind that before Triassic, you will not find calcareous nanoplanktons in the fossil record, because during the Triassic, specifically late Triassic, the biological and climatic changes that were happening, they helped in the proliferation of nanoplanktons in the ocean and dinosaurs on the land. The climate was getting warmer, humid, lot of flora was proliferating, they provided food, and so these large reptiles slowly started to emerge. So this is how we define the Triassic. The marine Triassic in India is confined to the Himalayas. It is all the Tethian sediments. So you will find marine Tethian fossils, which got uplifted in the Himalayan orogeny. Uplifted sequences. And the Triassic succession is best developed in Spiti in terms of the biostratigraphic contents and continuity. It means that the continuity word over here means that these are continuous sequences. You will rarely find unconformity. These are mostly conformable sequences. That is why it becomes a type locality to study the Triassic. The Triassic period in the Spiti Valley, or the Triassic system of the Spiti Valley, has been named as the Lelang supergroup. But earlier, Stolik Zaka was a geologist who used this term Lelang for only upper Triassic rocks. Then later, Hayden used Lelang supergroup for the Triassic system in Spiti. And even today, it is known as Lelang supergroup. Sometimes in some books, you may find words like Lalung supergroup, L-A-L-U-N-G, but then don't ignore all those. Best way to know the Spiti formation, Spiti Valley rocks, is the Lelang supergroup. So the Lelang supergroup is further divided into three groups: the Tambakorkur group, Sanglung group, Nimoloksa group, and at the top of the Lelang supergroup is the Kyoto group. So these three, Tambakorkur, Sanglung and Nimoloksa, they are the Lelang supergroup, and on the top of the Lelang supergroup is the Kyoto group. That if you see on the right hand side, I have put in some pictures of the fossils, which are the marker fossils for each formation. So we will discuss it one by one. The Tambakorkur group has been divided into three formations: the Mikin, Kaga and Komule. The Mikin formation is further divided into four members. So you can see here how lithostratigraphy is getting finer. I had discussed with you the other day. Mikin has four members, A, B, C, D, and A is the lowest member, the basal member. The basal member A is identified on the basis of the Otoceras bed. Otoceras. This is the Otoceras fossil. Otoceras was an ammonoid. Okay. So the occurrence of the Otoceras woodwardi marks the base of Lelang supergroup. These one word questions can be formed from this information, or MCQs can be formed. So you should keep all these in mind. So it is a Otoceras woodwardi, an ammonoid fossil, which is used to mark the base of the Lelang supergroup or the Mikin formation, and in the Triassic system of the Spiti Valley. It is followed by Hedonstromia bed, which is again an ammonoid. You can see here, it is an ammonoid. The Hedonstromia bed of the member B is overlain by member C, which is the Nitti limestone, and then D is the Muschelkalk. Name it as Himalayan Muschelkalk. Then the Mikin formation is overlain by the Kaga formation. Kaga formation has these bivalves, Daunilla. Daunilla bivalves are found in the shales. Shale is the dominant lithology in the Kaga formation. So you can see here, this is the Daunilla. And in Komule, you will find, apart from Daunilla, Helobia. Helobia beds are there. This is Helobia. This is again a bivalve. So Daunilla and Helobia limestone is in Komule formation. the Kaga formation is shaley formation, while Miken is again limestone formation. So you can see here that in the lowermost Tambakorkur group, the Miken and Komule formations are the ones which are dominating in limestone carbonate facies, while Kaga formation has shales as dominant lithology, which is the siliciclastic facies. The Tambakorkur group is overlain by the Sanglung group. Sanglung group has two formations, Rama formation and Rongtong formation. Rama formation has the gray beds. We'll see what these gray beds are. While the Rongtong formation is divided into lower, middle and upper members on the basis of one marker ammonoid, the tropitis. See, this is tropitis over here, the lower tropitis bed, middle tropitis bed and upper tropitis bed. Sanglung group is overlain by the topmost group of the Lilang supergroup, Nimoloxa group. Nimoloxa is further divided into four formations, Rangrik formation, Hangrang formation, Alarol formation and Nunuluka formation. Rangrik formation is further divided into two members, lower and upper, and interestingly, the lower member of the Rangrik formation is classified on the basis of Zoophycos, which is a trace fossil. Trace fossil. These are walking traces. Walking traces. Kind of a repycnia. So Zoophycos limestone. You can see here all these are the walking traces. And the upper member of Rongrik formation is divided on the basis of Jua White, which is again an ammonoid. Jua White bed. Hangrang formation is coralline limestone. It has limestone full of coral fossils. Alarur formation has Monotis shale. Dominant lithology is again siliciclastic sediments and Monotis is a bivalve. Then Nunuluka formation is the topmost. It has quartzite beds as the marker bed. Lilang supergroup is overlain by Kyoto group and it has one formation, the para formation, dominant in massive limestone beds, which is the para limestone. This is how the classification of the lithostratigraphic classification of Spiti Valley is done. So let us now look at each group one by one. The Tambakorkur group, it is almost 500 meters in thickness and the formations Miken, Kaga and Komule. The basal part of the Miken formation with thick shelly beds, it shows shallower marine environment above mean wave base. If you see my video on the wind generated waves, you will find the definition and details of what is the meaning of wave base, what it means to be above wave base and below wave base. Go through it. If you have any doubts and confusion, you can ask me again. So the basal part, it is having thick shelly beds, means it has all these rocks, which is quite thick in, you know, it is quite thick and it has these shelly fossils, you know, fossils of the shells of these fossils, which means that it shows shallower marine environment. So if you look at the Miken formation, the age is Induan to early late Ladinian, early late Ladinian. The Miken formation has the A, B, C, D members. The lowermost A member is the Otoceras bed. So it has hard ferruginous limestone, slightly dolomitic limestone, gray and concretionary limestone. So this is an important limestone bed. The fossils which are present in the A member A, they are rich in ammonoids and bivalves. Okay, and the marker genus is the Otoceras beds. Then the member B, it is limestone and shale member. Okay, so this is a thin wavy limestone with shale partings, and the compact limestone, hard limestones are rare. As I have told you, I have shown you the fossil Hedonostromia as well. Hedonostromia is again an ammonoid. Then the member C is the Neeti limestone. It has thin nodular limestones and in pockets or in local places you will find marl as well with the limestone. The fourth member, the member D, which is named as the Himalayan Muschelkalk, it has thin bands of limestone, marl and shale, and it is richly fossiliferous in fossils of ammonoids, brachiopods, gastropods and bivalves. See this paleogeographic map. At the Permo-Triassic boundary, at 251 million years, this is the location of India. And if you see carefully over here, this portion is the one where today Spiti Valley is located. And you can see that the place where today Spiti Valley is was under the water. It was under the sea. So this is the paleogeographic map of the lowermost formation, you know, of the Permo-Triassic boundary. And you can very well see the occurrence of the marine deposits here, because this area was under the sea. It was under the water. If we see the Induan and Aulonakian, you can see that again this place was inundated by the sea. If you see previously, let me just remove it. If you compare the area that was underwater at the Permo-Triassic boundary with the area that was underwater in the Induan and Aulonakian, you will find that the sea level was higher over here. The sea inundated more inside. Okay, so we can see here that in the early Triassic portion, we are from the paleogeographic maps, we are seeing that the water levels were rising. The sea was inundating. In the middle Triassic Anisian, you can see here that now this portion is all out of the water. You know, it is raised, it emerged, the sea levels fell. They went down during the Anisian. But during Ladinian, you can see again there was transgression. So in the previous, if you start from the Permo-Triassic boundary, this portion was underwater. In the early Triassic, Induan and Aulonakian, the sea transgressed more. During the Anisian, the sea regressed. The water levels were down. And the portion where the Spiti Valley is located today, this portion, it emerged, it came out. But during Middle Triassic, this portion again went underwater due to the transgression. The next formation is the Kaga form. So I have shown these till Ladinian because age of Mikin formation is Induan to early late Ladinian. So for Mikin formation, you can see how the sea transgressed and regressed, leading to the formation of these marine deposits, and they were emerged out of the water. Next, if we see the Kaga formation, conformably overlies Mikin formation. So this is an important thing which I told in the beginning, that the Triassic succession is more of a continuous succession. You will not find much of unconformity over here. Marl, shale, silt with thin bedded gray limestone and marly limestones, they are dominant in the middle and lower part. The commonly found fossils, they are bivalves and ammonoids, and the depositional environment is the neritic shelf. The portion of the sea which is, you know, the shelf portion which is in the neritic zone, that is called as the neritic shelf. And how do we know that it was neritic shelf? On the basis of the lithology. It tells us that the depositional environment was the neritic shelf. The Comule formation, late Ladinian to early Carnian, it also conformably, it is a continuous formation, overlies the Kaga formation. It has monotonous lithology, means only one lithology is dominant. that is limestones, thin to medium bedded dark gray to black limestones and marly limestones. Though it is rich in fossils, but it has lesser fossils than the Kaga formation, and fossils of bivalves are common while ammonites are rare. And the deposition environment has been found to be neritic shelf with calcareous sedimentation and strong terrigenous input. Okay. Look at this paleogeographic map. Here, during Carnian, means the Kaga formation, which was late Ladinian, and the Komule formation, early Carnian, we can see here that this area was still under the sea. But now, the sea levels were slowly regressing. They were going down. And the topmost, after the topmost Komule formation, comes the Sanglung Group. Sanglung Group, which has the Rama formation and the Rongtong formation. Rama formation is the lowermost formation, late early Carnian to early late Carnian. Okay, so it's early Carnian to the earlier part of late Carnian. See what is the position of the sea over here? It is still inundating. It has transgressed over the land part. So the Sanglung Group is in conformable succession with the previous one. Okay. The Komule formation, it is underlying the Rama formation. Rama formation has gray local carboniferous finest grained siltstone, shale, and limestone in cyclic order. So it has silt, shale, limestone, and therefore the environment varies from shallow subtidal shelf to deeper neritic basin. As we will be getting the different grain types, sediment grain types, then we can guess what is the water depth. And on the basis of these repeated cyclic beds of siltstone, shale, and limestone, we can deduce that the environment, it varied from subtidal shelf to deeper neritic basin. The fossils were of Bryozoa, this is A, not Z, A. Bryozoa, Echinoidea spines, mollusca, algae, foraminifera, bivalves, crinoids, porous, all these are commonly occurring fossils in the Rama formation. Rongtong formation has three members, lower, middle, and upper, divided on the basis of tropites. Okay, so lower tropite bed, middle tropite bed, upper tropite bed. So let us see again the tropites. So this one, this is tropite. Tropite is an ammonoid. Okay, means that it's all these are marine sediments over here, massive marine sediments. Now the lower tropite bed, that lower member, it is nodular limestone with basal shale interlayer, while the middle tropite, the middle member, the middle tropite beds, they are distinct sandstone and siltstone interval. Okay, at the base overlain by a mixed sequence of fossiliferous limestone, calcareous shale, and limestone with some marl. So the lower one was nodular limestone, it was a monotonous lithology. The middle one has siliciclastic as well as the carbonate beds, while the upper member is constituted of cliff forming thick to medium bedded limestone and dolomite with bivalve bearing limestone. So apart from tropites, you will find a lot of bivalves also preserved in the upper member of Rongtong formation. The commonly found sedimentary structures are cross beddings, wavy and nodular beddings, thin parallel beddings, mud cracks and channel fills. And it is found that the depositional environment is a storm-dominated ram. These deposits are also sometimes referred to as tempestites. The tempestites, they may be confused sometimes with the turbidity flows or turbidites. But then Tempestides, these are the storm deposits. Sometimes the storm may increase the inflow of the sediments in the rock record. While turbidites, they are the sediment flows themselves. And these are very, we can say, sudden events, catastrophic type of events. That is the storm-dominated trap. This is what I was talking about. Tempestite layers. The sedimentary environment is found to be subtidal to intertidal environment of moderate to high energy based on these deposits and the sedimentary structures that have been seen. The next one is the Nimoloxa group. The Nimoloxa group is divided into four formations: Rangrik, Hangrang, Alaror, and Nunuluka. And this group is dominated by a massive to bedded limestone beds. The Rangrik formation is early to middle Norian, and it conformably overlies the Rongtong formation. Lower member is dominated by limestone, while the upper member is dominated by sericiclastics. Okay. It has prograding cycles constituted of limestone, shale, siltstone, and sandstone. So when we say prograding cycles, it means that if, let us say, this is the basin and this is the water, sea level, this is the shore. So this is sea once the sea level starts to fall, then here, then you know that in such a case, the shoreline will start to shift towards the basin. So this is shoreline 1, shoreline 2, shoreline 3, like that. Under such circumstances, you will be getting prograding deposits like this. So it is the forward moving. It means that the previously deposited fine grain sediments will be overlain by relatively coarser grain sediments. That is what prograding means. So we can see here that limestone, which is the finest, followed by shale, then followed by siltstone, and the coarsest sandstone. If such type of deposits are found, then we can presume that the sea levels were going down and it was a prograding type of deposits which were formed. Interestingly, they have been, the lower member has been marked on the basis of a trace fossil called as Zoophycos, which is a Rapycnia. So Zoophycos trace fossils, body fossils, ripple marks, low angle cross beds, they indicate that it was low to moderate energy environment. The next one is the Hangrang formation, late middle Norian, light to dark gray limestone, which are massive to bedded. Now, coral knoll reefs, they are part of this litho unit, and it exhibits shallow ramp facies to deeper water environment. So you will find that there is a range of environment based on the lithology and the fossil record. The Alaror formation, now between the Hangrang and the Alalor lies an unconformity, which is a disconformity. So it disconformably overlies the Hangrang formation. Age is early late Norian. Age is early late Norian. So these are the, now we have entered the late Triassic, the upper part of the Triassic system, which the Alaror, it shows brachiopod rich limestone at the base, which is overlain by shale, siltstone to fine-grained sandstone, and then limestone. Again, here you will find that carbonate, shale, siltstone, they form several prograding cycles. You are finding that there is a coarsening upward sequence. Shallow marine deposition environment is there well above the wave base. Okay. And bivalves, monotis, and then hydrozoa, heterostridium, they are found in the upper part of formation, and then they indicate deeper neritic environment. So you can see here that there has been prograding cycles as well as the upper part of Alaror formation, it had deeper neritic environments as represented by the bivalve and hydrozoan fossils. The Nunuluka formation is a late Norian formation. It conformably overlies the Alaror formation. It has sandstones, shales and thick limestones and megalodon. Now, you must have heard of megalodon, which was a kind of shark. But then there is another bivalve also, megalodon. So, megalodon bivalves, they occur in abundance in a limestone bed in the upper part of Nunuluka formation. The commonly found sedimentary structures are ripple marks, crossbedding, herringbone crossbedding and wavy crossbeddings, and deposition environment is coastal to intertidal based on these sedimentary structures. So, if you see here in Norian, which is the middle part of the late Triassic, see the sea has regressed so much. This is lowering of the sea levels, regression that had caused the prograding cycles. And that is evident from this paleogeographic map, that this location where today there is Spiti Valley, the water levels were going down. Okay. So, while in the Riocene, that is the topmost stage of the Triassic, and overlying the Lelang supergroup is the Kyoto group. It consists extensively of limestone beds and it rests conformably over the Nunuluka formation. Thin to medium bedded limestone in the lower part and dolomite in the upper part are there in the Kyoto group, that is the Para formation. The carbonate microfaces which are present here, they consist of lithoclastic wake stone consisting of clast of bivalves filled with pelloidal mud. So these are all bivalve shells which are filled with these pelloids, pelloidal muds. Revise your sedimentary part of your first semester, you will come across all these terminology, wake stone, pack stone, grain stone, what they mean. Then fecal pellets, foraminiferal grain stones, bioclastic pack stone, these are very commonly found in the Para formation. Crinoid fragments are commonly found. Now, all these bioclasts, bivalve, gastropods, foraminifer, calcareous algae, they have been transported, and this transport was hydrodynamically controlled on the storm dominated shallow shelf. The deposition environment is the shelf edge sand area with tidal channels. This has been known on the basis of the lithology which is exhibited by the carbonate microfaces. So in the late Triassic in Riocene, now see the condition of the Tethys Sea. It has all regressed. So this portion over here, this is what we today call as the Spiti Valley. Okay. So by looking at the paleogeographic map, it becomes clear that there were several episodes of transgression and regression. Of course, they are all shallow marine structures which were present over there, but the deposition environment varied in the Spiti Valley, and that has been evident from the various types of fossil record as well as the lithology and sedimentary structures. So this completes the Triassic stratigraphy of the Spiti Valley.